hear me and see me clearly enough. First of all, thank you to the organizers for inviting me and for putting this on. It's always a lot of work to put on an event like this. And this has been a really good event so far anyway. I don't know what's going to happen now, but and thank you to the sponsors because we need money for these things. So thank you very much. Well done. I hope we see more of this.
Yeah, sure.
This is my favourite part of the talk where I talk about myself. My name is Daniele Procida. That's what I look like on television. It actually says here that I am Python software. So. I work for a Swiss software company called Devio, and we have a Python Django cloud hosting platform so that developers don't need to be DevOps or worse, system administrators. And I'm a Python Django developer myself. I'm a core developer of the Django project and a board member, actually the vice president of the Django Software Foundation. But it's not nearly as glamorous as I could imagine it might be. There's my email address, so feel free to drop me a line. And I'm on IRC and GitHub and sometimes Twitter, not very much, people DMP. Can you all hear me, by the way?
Yeah,
I understand. Or best of all, just come and talk to me, so I'll meet you. So, you knew this already, that better documentation will make your project, your team, or whatever, more successful, so I'm not telling you anything new. When you share your software with the world or your team, you want them to use it. But many projects and authors fall foul of a very simple principle, even knowing this, that it doesn't matter how good the software is, if the documentation isn't good enough, then the world is not going to use your software. If it's not good enough, or if it doesn't even exist, the world is going to decide that your project, your software, is just too much trouble for them, and they'll find something else to solve their problems with. And you can't force them to do it. Well, maybe you can if they're your employees or your henchmen or something like that. I don't know how many henchmen you get in your company, but even if you force your henchmen to use your software, without good documentation, they won't use it very well. So you need good documentation in order for people to use your software well. And of course, as I said, you know this already, and most people try to create good documentation. They know that they need it, and they try, and mostly they fail. And it's not because they're not trying hard enough, it's usually because they're not doing it in the right way. And what I hope to explain is some ways in which you can make your documentation better, not by doing more of it or working harder on it, but just by changing the way you do it, because you're probably doing it wrong. And I skipped over that quickly because I don't seem like an overweening know-it-all. I probably am one, but I don't seem like one. The easier way is the right way. It's easier to write and to maintain documentation when you do it the right way. And there are some very simple principles governing this that I've never seen spelled out, except by me. So in all the documentation that I write, I always make a point of spelling it out there. So you'll see it in certain places, like in the Django documentation. These principles seem to be secrets for some reason. And they certainly shouldn't be. And I'm going to spell them out here again for you, so they stop being secrets. And that's my promise, that this talk will make your project more successful, if you listen to me and believe me. And for your team or your product or whatever it is. And here's the secret, that there is not one thing called documentation. There are actually four distinct kinds of documentation, and they represent four different purposes or functions, and they are tutorials, how-to guides, reference guides, and discussions. This is a bad word, probably, discussions. I mean something like background material or explanations. I don't mean chats between people, okay? So discursive material. My contention is that documentation needs to be explicitly structured around these four different functions, each of which requires a distinct mode of writing, and that people working with software need each of these four different kinds of documentation at different times or in different circumstances. So usually, almost always, all four of these are necessary in your documentation. And they must be kept separate and distinct from each other, because keeping them entirely separate or demarcated is key to creating successful documentation and making it easy to maintain, which is part of being successful. So this structure makes it obvious both to the reader and to the author what information goes where. It tells the author how to write and what to write and where to put it. It saves the author from wasting a great deal of time wondering where to put stuff or wondering what tone to take in a particular section, and wasting time trying to shape the documentation, because things, when you're writing documentation, people find is they're never quite sure how to structure or shape, impart a form to what they're doing, even if they have the content. Organizing it is often a large part of that work. Here, each part of the structure has one and only one very clear job. So let's just quickly go through them. If I wanted to bet £100 with each person in the room that your tutorials and your documentation are not up to scratch, I might not win every bet, but I'd definitely leave the room with a profit. So tutorials are actually hard to do. They are lessons that take the reader by the hand through a series of steps to complete a project. They're what your project needs to show the beginner. They're what your project needs to do to show the beginner that they can do something useful with your software. And you want to give the beginner the best possible start through your tutorial. Tutorials are learning oriented. If you want an analogy, think about teaching a young child to cook. I don't know if anyone has done this. It's messy, isn't it? What you teach the child is pretty much irrelevant. The important thing that the child learns is that the kitchen is an enjoyable place to do things, gains confidence with the tools and things in the kitchen, and wants to do it again. So it doesn't actually matter whether, at any particular point, whether they've learned something or not, or whether you've taught them the right thing. You've set them up so that they want to be there and are able to come back to get more of it when they're ready. And it's through the things the child does that it will learn. It will learn all the important things about cooking, including many that you take for granted, that you wash your hands before handling food, for example. Now, what matters here is learning by doing, because using software, using anything in fact, is a craft or a skill. And when we learn a new craft or skill, we always learn it by doing. And using software like cooking is a matter of skill. It's knowledge, but it's practical rather than theoretical knowledge. So your learner must do. The point of the tutorial is to get learners started on their journey, not to take them up to expert level or to even to competence, but just to get them started. It has to inspire their confidence so they trust you, so they trust the software you're giving them. You even have to make them trust themselves, to give them confidence in themselves through your tutorial. For this to happen, then the tutorial must work, and it's got to work for just everybody, no matter what their platform, no matter what their skill levels. You have to work very hard when you're writing your tutorial that you cover every case, every operating system, every version of them, the different tools people might be using. When you're there with the beginner, that's very easy to help them when they run into a problem. When they're just reading something you've written, that's really hard. it's got to be repeatable every single time. Every single person who does the tutorial needs to be able to get the same results. It has to give your learners an immediate sense of achievement. Everything the learner does should accomplish something they can understand that's comprehensible and meaningful, however small it is. Tutorials need to be concrete and not abstract. They're built around specific, particular outcomes and actions. In this kind of learning, the learning proceeds from the concrete and the particular to the abstract and the general, not the other way around. So there's absolutely no place for explanation in a tutorial. It doesn't belong there. It gets in the way and impedes the learning of the beginner. So you don't explain anything that the learner does not need in order to do. The child doesn't need to know about the proteins in the egg and how they behave when they're heated. That's not going to make the cooking lesson enjoyable for the child. Same with the software. Give them the result that they understand, that they can see as a result of their actions. And don't distract your learner with multiple choices or options or alternatives or interpretations. Just give them something to do. It's your responsibility because you're the teacher. So don't say, if you want to, and then start giving them confusing options. You take them to something, and it's your responsibility to do that from end to end. I used to be a high school teacher, so I'm not quite sure what my pupils learned, but I learned, there's one thing that I learned from that experience. I wasn't a high school teacher for very long. As a courtesy both to myself and to them, I decided I should do something different. So most software projects have got bad or non-existent tutorials. And they're so important because a tutorial is what will turn a learner into a user or a web browser into a customer or something like that. They will get people over that hump into using your software. A bad or missing tutorial will prevent you from acquiring new users. They're the hardest thing of all to write and maintain. Most projects lack them, probably yours, even some of the ones that I think are pretty good, could always be improved. It's very hard for developers to write this kind of stuff. It always works better if it's a new developer or somebody who's not very experienced, because then they have that kind of empathy and sympathy and understanding of things from the beginner's perspective that the more experienced developer who's looking outside from the inside doesn't have. Next, how-to guides. Guides that take the reader through some steps required to solve some specific common problem. So these are like recipes, directions to achieve a specific end, how to create a web form, how to plot a three-dimensional data set, how to authenticate through LDAP. And they're problem-oriented. If you want an analogy, there's a recipe. So for preparing something to eat, maybe you've got some ingredients, you're wondering what can I do with these ingredients, or you've got an idea for a dish, you want to know how to make it. But anyway, there's a clear defined end, it addresses a specific problem, and it takes goes through steps to get there. So these are completely distinct from tutorials. Don't get them confused. And how-to guide is an answer to a question that a true beginner might not even be able to formulate. In the tutorial, you know what an end is that somebody might be trying to achieve. By the time the user's at this stage, they've got an idea of what it is they might be trying to achieve, and you're going to help them along the way. Here, they've got a certain amount of responsibility. In the tutorial, you're the one who's responsible as the teacher. These tend to be done fairly well in software because they're fun to write for developers. What matters here, a series of steps, just like in a tutorial, that need to be followed in some sort of order. You don't have to start at the very beginning, you don't have to be complete, you don't have to go end to end, but they need to be reasonably reliable, even if they don't have that kind of cast iron repeatability of a tutorial. They need to be focused on some practical goal. That's why somebody's reading. They want to know, how do I do such and such? Anything else about getting from here to there is a distraction. It's about addressing a specific question. How do I do such and such? It shouldn't explain anything unnecessary. Once again, just like tutorials, explanations are important, but not here. So you link to your explanations. Explanations get in the way of action. You need a bit of flexibility, because people are coming at these things from different ways, so don't nail it down to only one possible way of doing it. Practical usability matters much more than theoretical completeness. It doesn't have to explain every detail of the theory behind something, as long as somebody gets some useful outcome from it. And good naming helps. So a tutorial should be called something like how to create a class-based view, not class-based views or creating class-based views. Reference guides are technical descriptions of the machinery and how to operate it. They've only got one job, to describe. They're code-determined, because that's what they're describing. So they'll describe APIs, key functions, methods, classes. So reference materials say things like, a Django model is a Python class. This is how you create a model. These are the available model fields. This is how you instantiate a model. This kind of material is information oriented. By all means, you can use examples in here, including some practical examples. But it's not about the examples, and you can mention concepts, but it's not about the concepts. The concepts need to be explained elsewhere. It just has to be austere and to the point, just the facts about the machinery. So here's another, I don't know whether you can see this, it's a bit small, but this is an encyclopedia entry about ginger, the food, the ingredient here. So that's the kind of form that material, that reference material should take. It's only describing, it's not giving us recipes. Introducing us to the folklore of it. It's just the facts. In reference material, what matters is the structure. It should have the same structure as the code base or the software or the machinery, in other words, or the architecture, whatever it is you're describing, so the user can navigate through the documentation just as they navigate through their interactions with the software. You need to be consistent, as consistent as an encyclopedia is in its form and tone and structure, so people always know where they are. The only thing that matters is description. Explanation is not necessary. Tuition is not necessary. And of course, it has to be kept accurate and up to date, because any discrepancy between the machinery and the way it behaves and your description of it means that somebody will lose an eye or a hand if they're not careful. If that's farm machinery, but software is safer, thank God. Otherwise, we will be standing here with patches on our eyes, given the state of our documentation. So, yeah, you know, think about how many errors we tolerate. So, it needs to match. It needs to match in order to be useful. Now, for some developers, this is the only kind of documentation that they imagine. They know how to use the software. All they can imagine that other people need is some kind of technical information about it to remind them. So they just write technical reference, and that's okay. But then, because they haven't made space in their documentation for the other things, like the tutorials or the how-to guides, they start entering into the reference material, thus spoiling the reference material that started out so nicely. So, not having the structure even damages other things. And finally, discussions or background topics, or whatever you want to call them, but they're explanations that clarify and illuminate some particular topic. And these are oriented towards understanding. They're a chance for the documentation to relax and step back from the software, taking a slightly wider view of it. And my analogy is, I don't know if you know Harold McGee's book on food and cooking. So it's a book about the history, sociology, and other background discussions of food and cooking. 12 and 3. So explanations are the place for this kind of background and content. So you might have a topic on web forms and how they're handled in Django, or search and this such and such a product. They're important because they give context that might not be obvious if you're very close to the software. They explain why things are the way they are. Design decisions or historical reasons. In discussions, you can consider alternatives, you know, contrary opinions, other ways of doing things, multiple approaches to the same question. They make connections between things, so people, when they're taking this slightly longer view, can see how things join up from a distance. But they're not the place for any kind of instruction or technical description, because those belong in other places. Discussions are actually quite, they can be harder to create than it seems, because things are quite straightforward to explain when you've got the starting point of a question, like, how do I do such and such? But when you've got a blank page and now you're expected to write about web forms in general, that's quite a tricky thing to do. So anyway, here are the four quadrants in my schema software documentation. And as I say, I think that as soon as the characteristics of one of these quadrants, of one of these kinds of documentation, starts to appear in another, then the quality of the documentation as a whole starts to fall. In other words, if you're going to add new material to your documentation, if you add it to the wrong place, you're going to make the documentation worse and not better. And it will be less useful to your reader and harder for you to maintain. So it should look like that, and then it inevitably looks something like that. So here they are in their own quadrant. But I want to show you, don't worry, I'll have an even better slide at the end with everything in it. I want to show you where some of the tensions arise. Tutorials and how-to guides, they're both concerned with practical steps. So they're similar in that respect. Whereas how-to guides and reference material are useful when you're actually doing the coding to have this stuff by your side. And then reference material discussions are about theoretical knowledge. So they're alike in that respect. And what tutorials have in common with discussions is that they're most useful when we are studying rather than actually coding. So you've got these kind of magnetic or gravitational pulls between these different sections, and that's what happens. It ends up looking like that when it should look like that. So if you want to take a photo, that's not. So when it does look like this, you will have documentation that will work, that's easier to write and to maintain, that's easier to find your way around in, both as a reader and an author. And it won't write itself, because unfortunately it never does, but you'll have a much clearer idea of what to write, how to write it, and where to put it. And your users will be served better. Because for all the different phases in the cycle of their interactions with your software or your system, they will find the right kind of documentation that serves the needs of that moment. And your software will attract and keep more users who will use it more effectively, which is, after all, what you really want when you've created software for people to use. So, very briefly, you find this structure in the Django project, tutorials, topic guides, discussions, they call them topic guides, reference guides, and how-to guides. Another project I'm involved in, Django CMS, tutorials, how-to guides, reference, and discussions called key topics there. This is one I'm not involved with, that has taken this. So we've got tutorial, how-to, reference, discussion. This is from a mathematical library. Here's a queuing simulation library in Python. Tutorials, how-to guides, reference, and background or discussion. You see the word discussions is a difficult one, and so on. So if you find any more or do it yourself, let me know so I can add to my collection. Last chance to take your photograph on that slide. but I've I've written this up. It's on our weblog, so that's dvo.com/blog/documentation. So all the material's there. I'll put it up on the screen. And that's it. Thank you very much. Any questions? Have you got time for a couple of questions? Yes, thank you. I realize that all the things I talk about, like DVO and Django and Dockerized Django deployments and documentation, all begin with D. So fucking talking to me about anything beginning with D. Yes.
Could I make 30 seconds for a pithy comment on, you've identified there four documentation types. What's your view over the fact that the DITA documentation standard only identifies three basic types, the concept, the task, and the reference?
The what?
The DITA documentation.
You'll have to tell me more about that, but okay. What are they, concept, task, and?
Concept, task, and reference.
So that in effect, is concept would be discussions, task would be how-to guides, and reference?
Yeah.
Would be reference. What about the tutorial for getting people started?
I think they have a new learning.
Yes, please.
If you have a topic, how to open, you have a topic, how to close, have a topic, how to edit, how to delete, when you get to a table of contents, that means you've got a user having to read how to. How do you get around that problem?
Well, in Sphinx, I do it by the title of each document is how to do a such and such, but then in the table of contents, it says how to guides, and then so it will say something like how to open a this.
Do you have half the table of contents to get around it?
Just that, yeah, just short and truncated, yes, yeah. But that's a good question, because it seems, you know, it's, people love to say it's not rocket science, of course it's not rocket science, but it does require some thought to present people with a table of contents that makes them feel, just by looking at it, that they've got a way in. So that's important too. So that's an important question. Yes, please.
In the same way you've explained 12 to 4 quadrants, it seems very useful as a mental model. Do you find that you would put a little bit of introductory information on some of the sites you provide to say, actually, here's how you might think of these? Or do you hope that the user finds it self-explanatory through the titles?
Oh, no. Whenever I write documentation,
cool.
I think it's important to be explicit, because people don't always realize this, and it does imply that we say explicit is better than implicit. I think that's definitely true.
Sorry, quick follow-up. You then presumably, although they're four quite distinct sections, I'm guessing they're quite heavily interlinked, so you're pointing to the detail.
So linking takes a lot of pressure off the author when the temptation comes to start, I'd better add a paragraph that explains this concept when I'm, you know, in the tutorial, for example, which is not fatal, nobody ever dies doing that. But it is harmful to put an explanation like that. It becomes a stumbling block that people now fall over. Are they supposed to understand that before they can move on? No, it doesn't matter. The only important thing is what they do. In fact, I'll share this with you. When I was doing my high school teacher training, the most painful and most important lesson I learned was from a teacher who took me aside after a dismal lesson that I thought was going to go brilliantly, and she said, look, what you teach them is irrelevant. The only thing that matters is what they do. And I took that to heart, and it's helped me a lot. So, So by all means, you have a link from your tutorial to your explanation, so they can go and find it there, if or when they want to do it later, because later they will want to find it. But the link will take the pressure off you, the feeling that you've got an obligation to explain something.
Change something in one part, yeah. How do you make sure that having
Well, I use some, it's not really the time, I use Sphinx and RST, restructured text. So at any point in the documentation, I can put a reference and say this will be the reference for such and such. And I can put, then I can move that anywhere else in the documentation. All the links to it will automatically update. So if you'd like to talk about Sphinx and RST, I can actually show you. It's very easy and it's a, it's the best documentation tool I know. I can, if anybody wants to see it, I can help them set it up on their own machines in a few minutes. It's very easy. There was another question.
Yes, is there anywhere on your blog that links to the four types of documentation so we could see an example?
On this URL?
Yeah, or any other.
There probably is in here, but I mean, if you go to the, start with the Django project, go to docs.djangoproject.com, you'll see it there on the first page.
Okay.
That structure is explicitly there.
If you want.
Sorry?
So one last question.
Yeah.
Like, I would argue that an explanation of what your product is should also be part of your documentation. Like, I've seen that you're doing it. Like, we had this discussion about worked examples, and as worked examples as a way into your tutorials, so that like to get people started, like someone who's not committed yet, that they actually want to go and do a tutorial because like they're just like kicking the tires of your project, that they can just read something and say, oh, actually this does what I wanted to do, so this is going to be the right tool for me. And then they start with the tutorials.
Yeah, so if I go to this, so, you know, I mean,
yeah,
there's some stuff down there that I haven't shown you, and there's some stuff there, and these are not the only four sections in the documentation.
Yeah.
But the other stuff, for example, the governance of the project, that's not about the software, that's about the project. There's even, we had somebody talked about the distinction between documentation for developers and documentation for kind of end users.
Yeah.
So this is for a CMS, for the editors of the CMS. That, there's actually a little section tucked away that's separate for actually using Django CMS as a content editor rather than as a developer. But they're not part of the actual software documentation. So things like our commit policies, the history of the CMS, the release logs, they're not part of this. They're metadata about the project. But as soon as we start talking about the software proper, then it has to be in that. So I like to put this quite close to the front of the documentation because chances are that people have an idea whether they want to use your thing or not, and marketing information should be kept to a minimum. You know, you want to give them something straight away. Yeah.
Thanks.
But, I think I'm probably sadly out of time, much as I enjoy the sound of my own voice. So, if anybody would like to talk about any of these things or wants to have a look at Sphinx, I'm really happy to do that while I'm still around today. So thank you very much for your attention.